up to speak on. Maybe. Thank you.
Mr. Thomre, I think you are muted.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I would invite Duty Sir to speak on IIB. Over to Duty Sir.
You are on mute, sir.
Devte sir, I think we have an issue with your audio. I mean, we cannot hear you clearly. Hello,
Devte sir. No, we cannot hear you at all.
Sir, I think it's with your earphones. There's some issue with your earphones.
No, Devte sir, there is.
May I request?
Dilip sir, can you bring the microphone close to your mouth? No, there is some other issue. It's not working. Or you can remove the microphone from the computer and then try.
Can you listen?
No.
Yes,
absolutely.
Yes, sir.
Perfect.
Good evening, everybody. I welcome you all for this special lecture series. As by this time, everybody knows that IIB was established in 1989 by Mr. M.C. Bhide, and since then, the IIB is actively working in the field of bridge engineering for the development of bridge engineering knowledge and spreading the bridge engineering knowledge. As we have seen, it has got since beginning it has many technical issues and printed so many those things I'll not repeat. So coming back to today's subject, I have engineer Mr. Goel and make his presentation. Also today there is a special presentation by sponsor. So without taking much time, I think we'll start our today's session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for the brief introduction of IIB.
I
would like to introduce our panelist. Panelist is Professor Pradeepta Banerjee. Can you share? Yeah. Yeah, it's pleasure to introduce Sir Pradeepta Banerjee. Professor Pradeepta Banerjee was director of Indian Institute of Technology from October 2013 to October 2016. Since November 2016, he had resumed to the parent organization of Technology Bombay as a professor of civil engineering, and from February 2017 to June, he was head for Center for Urban Science and Engineering at IIT Bombay. He has been a faculty member at IIT Bombay since 1988. During his period, he was awarded the Excellency in Teaching Award, and he has been the Dean, Alumni and International Relations, for two terms of 3 years each, apart from holding various other administrative positions. He has been visiting professors at Technical University in Germany and in Canada, and has been invited as a keynote speaker at many international workshops. So on behalf of IIB, I invite and welcome today's panelist, Professor Pradeepta Banerjee. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Now, I would like to introduce today's speaker. Our today's is Sri Ravindra Kumar Goel. Yeah, everyone knows him. He's a very well-known engineer in Indian Railways. Sri Ravindra Kumar Goel is an IRSE officer of Indian Railways from 1988 batch. He has long of design, fabrications, construction and maintenance of railway bridges. During his long working at BNSDT of RDSO, he had worked on various projects with different IITs, revised the 40 provisions of IRSE Steel Bridge Code, and developed guidelines for seismic design of railway bridges. He holds special diploma in bridge engineering from Majors Rambol, Denmark. As chief engineer on Central Railway, he has been approvals of designs and drawings for road over bridges. He had issued comprehensive guideline for design, fabrications, inspections, and maintenance on Central Railway. He is also associated with Indian Institute of Bridge Engineers since long, and has presented several papers in seminars. So I welcome engineer Ravindra Kumar Goel to give today's webinar on sustainable policy issues, design, construction, and health monitoring bridges. Over to Goel sir. Thank you.
Am I audible?
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Welcome, sir.
So, So a very good evening to everybody. This is a very important date, and it's a very tough topic as well. I have just tried to touch upon this, the fringes of this topic, but I that whatever I will say, it will bring some new thoughts to the people who are listening to this talk. So sustainable bridge policy issues in design, construction and health monitoring of bridges. Actually, there are issues of increasing speeds and axle loads as on date on Indian Railways, and as well as on roads also. The government of governments are to increase the speeds, and the biggest bottleneck is the old bridges which were constructed long ago. Standards for which they were designed, they were not even known, and now we have to run the traffic as per the latest standards on the on those old. So the vital question is what to do about those bridges which for which the design standards are even not known. So this is posing a real challenge. Now, bridge. According to me, a bridge which can be sustained even after its design service life is completed, with or without strengthening or retrofitting for the speeds, can be said a sustainable bridge. When we say strengthening, that means we are trying to make the bridge fit for the existing standards. And when we say retrofitting, we mean that we are trying to make the bridge fit for the increased or the higher loading standards. The need to be assessed for higher speed and axle loads to ensure safety and serviceability on the bridges. And we all know that railway infrastructure is largely old. It was created in the 19th century and early 20th century. Part of it was rebuilt, and many times upgradations were done to doing the gauge conversion. And the broad gauge traffic was run on the old bridges with some strengthening measures. So large parts of the bridges are almost 100 years old. More than 20% of the bridges, existing bridges, might be more than 100 years old. So many bridges are sustaining loads and speeds far higher than their design loads. And efficient maintenance management of existing railway bridges is essentially required to sustain the traffic over them. So it involves activities such as condition assessment, safety assessment, monitoring, strengthening and rebuilding, etc. So there are different kinds of bridges with having different types of configurations and materials. Some of these common type of structure and configurations are open web girders. They can be of through type, they can be of underslung type. We have got in plenty, which are mostly of open deck type. Then we have got composite steel girders, ballasted deck type, PSC slabs and girders. They are mostly of PSC slabs are up to 12.2 meter span, and PSC girders are 18.3 meter of span, mostly. Of course, some of the PSC girders are higher spans also, up to 50 meter, mostly commonly, but they have been designed in a specific cases for bigger spans also. Arch bridges, mostly in brick masonry and stone masonry. RCC boxes, stone slabs, etc. They are of very, very small, so they are not posing much of the problems. And then some new developments are taking place. We are getting now four ROVs, bowstring type of arches, cable stayed bridges also, mostly in ROVs. And now a very recently a new cable stayed bridge is coming up on Indian Railways in J&K at Anji Khad, steel arch bridges. Now, why old bridges are to be sustained? First of all, we have to understand that the cost of rebuilding of a bridge huge, and irrespective of the cost, the issues involved in rebuilding of a large bridge are too many, because you can bridge on the same alignment. You have to introduce the curves on approach, which eats away the speed potential. So there is a pressing need on the bridge owners to sustain the existing bridges somehow, either by strengthening or by doing. So rebuilding of small bridges is also not desired in a very big way, because it requires speed restriction before rebuilding. Mostly the smaller bridges are being replaced with the help of RCC boxes, which are precast in nature. That job is done in traffic blocks. But that amount of such traffic blocks for number of small bridges is, if it is too much, then it is prohibitive and you cannot get the work done very fast. And then, of course, the speed restrictions are required at least for a week in advance. So if too many speed restrictions are there in a section, then it is difficult to run the traffic. Challenges are to identify the new areas of studies and research and training of engineers and developing institutions which may have skilled manpower and increase the loading and create domain expertise. And then we also have to relook at the policy for construction of new bridges so that the new bridges sustained later on after the completion of their design life for a extended service life. So in this context, when we looked into the experiences of other countries, we have found that in European Union, they have done a very big job. They did a project called Sustainable Bridge. So this Sustainable Bridge project was a joint effort of 17. Planning and execution of FP6 project sustainable bridges. It was meant for assessment of future traffic demands and analyze and to suggest how to make the existing bridges fit for running heavier axle loads and higher speeds. So this is the sustainable bridge concept. It was taken up by European Union in 2003. It was to assess the readiness of railway bridges to meet the demands of 2020 scenario. We already processed that 2020-21, and it was to provide the means to upgrade the bridges, existing bridges, if they fall short of some strength parameters. So it required increased capacities with the heavier loads and larger forces to be absorbed due to longer, faster trains and mixed traffic. So all types to be considered in this project. So there was a consortium of 32 partners from 12 countries, including 8 clients, 6 railway administrations, UK, Sweden, Poland, Finland, and 2 road administrations, Sweden and Finland. They were partners. Gross budget was at that time about 10 million euros, which is less than about 100 crores of. And the kickoff meeting was somewhere in December 2003. And the project was finished in time in November 2007. And reports came in 2008. The objective, as I have said, it was to increase the transport capacity of existing bridges by allowing higher axle loads. That was the objective, to check the adequacy of the existing bridge, axle load of 33 tons for freight traffic and moderate speeds, or by that was for the freight trains for moderate speeds, and by allowing higher speeds of 50 kmph for passenger traffic with low axle loads. And residual service lives of existing bridges was to be extended up to 25% as per the objective, and enhance management systems, whatever is required so that this objective is completed. So the highlights of this European projects, that group of railway owners, they mapped the echo of railway bridges. The survey of about 220,000 bridges was done, which was spread over 17 different railways, and which were a total of about 3 lakh railway bridges across Europe. So what I have tried, they have developed some guidelines. I have tried to give you a brief overview of the important aspects of one of the guidelines in this presentation. These are the stakeholder organizations which were part of the project. It had most of the universities and some of the material research laboratories, some consultant, COVI, and mostly other technical institutes. So this was the holistic concept that they thought of. They divided the complete project outcomes into different work, starting from the work package, startup and classification, then guidance and review, then the work package 3, condition assessment and inspection, is broadly briefly touched upon by me. Then WP4, loads, capacity and resistance. Then work package 6, repair and strengthening, and then demonstrating field testing and of old bridges, then demonstration of monitoring of new bridges. And the most important thing is wherein they have given emphasis to training and dissemination of knowledge. The bridges that they covered in their study had proportions, different kinds of proportions, like 41% of arches of masonry, stone or concrete, 23% concrete bridges, 22% steel beam, 14% steel concrete composite bridges. About 35% of the bridges were more than 100 years old. So the situation was more or less like that of Indian railways. 10% of the bridges were less than 10 years old. Small bridges were quite large in number, about 62%, and only 5% bridges were having span larger than 40 meters. So top priority research areas that they decided were about the better assessment tools, non-disruptive maintenance methods, verification third factors. This is a very important aspect. This I will cover briefly in subsequent slides also, how RDSO takes care of it while assessing this. And then use of new materials, system of diagnosis and maintenance, then aging deterioration of concrete bridges, and then indirect inspection and monitoring vision, oblique crack detection in metalling bridges, that is to fatigue cracks, about the evaluation of fatigue cracks, repairs and waterproofing of concrete, better testing methods for existing bridges, serviceability. So total number of deliverables that they identified were more than 120, and 4 of them have been transformed into guidelines. 4 guidelines are the most important project outcome for the end user. The guideline on inspection and condition assessment, that is numbering, it has SBICA 2007. It gives a general guidance on condition assessment of railway bridges. It recommends a method for condition rating based on the characterization of the type, location, extensity of defects encountered in the bridge elements. The defect catalog, which is attached to SBICA 2007, assists the bridge inspectors in the objective and accurate identification and realization of the defects and damage most commonly encountered in existing railway bridges. We will be covering about these types of defects, how they have taken into consideration. Now, this is an important aspect which they have touched upon. That was the review of inspection procedure for bridges in Europe, and then suggesting what should be a proper inspection periodicity or procedure. So if you see, they have summarized the Sweden, like country like Sweden. Sweden, they had a system of inspection, yearly inspection, wherein railway technician has taken a specified course. One day deals with bridge inspection and pass the examination. That means a trained technician will conduct this and it will be a purely visual inspection. And then after every 6 years, there would be a principal inspection, which is also called main or major inspection. And then inspection whenever is required. It will depend on what type of situation is there, what is to be examined. And often a structural engineer and oblique OT expert. So the emphasis is on that only a qualified structural engineer and an expert of NDT should be entrusted this inspection. And it also includes more advanced test methods if required. This is the existing system. And similarly for Germany, they also insist for structural and certificate required for the inspector and then specialist supported by the inspectors. This is for other countries, United Kingdom. They also insist for trained examiner which should be meeting the requirements of their some specification. Additional examination if required, then again to be done by trained examiner. Poland, Finland, and France, they are depending on the professional knowledge, qualified people for inspection. Now there is a system management. The network owner or the decision maker, whosoever is owning the bridge, he has to have a integrated management system in which all the documentation of system data, design, drawings, material data, and then the inspection records, whatever measurements are being done, regular inspections or the special inspections, any preventive maintenance is being done, all those records are to be kept there. Then maintenance inputs being given, remedial measures, if any, taken, repair, strengthening, and other knowledge-based database like defects can be there, methods, different methods of retrofitting or strengthening materials, and then all other scientific approaches. They are all to be under one integrated management system. Now, this is the proposed inspection procedure by the Sustainable Bridge Project. They suggested that there should be inspections. Surveillance inspection should be continuous by the track staff, which is a general practice in Indian Railways also. And then there should be a routine inspection 1 year. We should be a visual inspection. And then they have suggested a principal inspection after every 3 years, which shall be done by the inspector, same person who had been regularly inspecting every year, along with the structural engineer, if required. This will be a very qualified person again. And they will require visual tests if needed, not any special type of testing instruments. And then general inspection after 6 years, wherein a structural engineer, necessary specialist in case of any doubts. So visual inspection in touching distance, within a touching distance, is prescribed for that. So after that, mitigation, if required, then specialized laboratories are to be employed. And long-term evaluating, if it is required, then again, specialized laboratories are to be entrusted this job. So then all, for condition assessment, digital implementation of inspection results in condition assessment. So these are the recommendations of the Sustainable Bridge Project. Now, this is again a very important slide. The emphasis is again on expertise and training. In some countries, regularly experts' opinion of every 6 years. That means by regulation, they have made it mandatory that after every 6 years, there would be a principal inspection or investigation, mandatory, which will be mandatory as part of the main inspection. The engineers with a minimum 5 years of experience in bridge engineering, bridge design or bridge rating are allowed to present expert opinions. Not like that anybody whosoever has been on the post, irrespective of his past experience, he can give his opinion. That doesn't matter actually. That cannot be considered as an expert opinion. So in Germany, the experts need a welding certificate. Authorities control the education and training level of the experts. Experts' opinion can be planned in phases, adapted to a phase-wise perform reassessment. A complete chapter on guideline for load and resistance assessment for this. So after this, they have given a system of phase-wise redressal of the doubts. So this will be more clear in the next slide. Regular inspections are being done by the people who are deployed for maintenance. Then if there are any doubts, then assessment has to be done in phase-wise. Then the data, whatever is generated out of the inspection, will be used for condition assessment. Decision making is required to be done after 3 phases of inspection. This will make it more clear. Routine inspections are done after every 3rd year, general after every 5th and 6th year. Then during the regular inspections, if there are no doubts, then there is okay, nothing is to be done. But if there are doubts, to go for phase 1 inspection, which includes site visit study of documents, and simple design checks. And it has to be done by the engineer alone. And visual inspection and basic entity, if required, can be done. In case the doubts are confirmed, or rather it confirmed, then there is no issue. We have to do nothing. We will simply go as per the routine inspection subsequently. But if the doubts are confirmed, then we will go with more detailed phase two inspection, in which engineer alone, along with specialized laboratories specialists, and the engineer together with team of experts go and visit. And in such a case, advanced entity update of construction plans would be done. So based on this analysis, again, if they check the safety, if the bridge is found safe, then there is nothing more required to be done, intensify the monitoring. And if the safety is still in doubt, then we see what are the consequences of putting speed restrictions or other remedial. If the consequences are not large, then we straight away reduce the loads, go for the strengthening or other measures to bridge. And if the consequences are large, that means it is not easily possible to close down the bridge even for a small period of time, then they go for a fit inspection, which includes site visits, discussions, and consensus within the team, and probabilistic approach. And it's a very high level of then inspection. You putting the patient into ICU, you one can say. And after that, they find that a decision is to be taken. Then this decision making is to be done in phase four making authorities to reduce the loads, strengthen the structure, and demolish the structure. Now they have developed a system, laid down system of hierarchical classification, wherein different levels are fixed for classification of different types of defects, like deformation, deterioration, in different types of members, steel construction, whether it is inorganic or organic, whether it is neutral or penetrating superficial, like that. It's a complete classification system of different types of defects in different types of bridges, also steel, concrete, SMZ, etc. Now, this is the picture which shows how they classify the defects. Like, this is the concrete. This is for steel. This contamination can be because of some weed growth in concrete, simple. Then in steel structures at the joints, there can be some dirt accumulation, some other minor rusting. And in case of masonry, again, some vegetation growth on the arch bridges. Can be bending strain in RCC. And then here in steel, you can see the deformation of the web member, then ring of the arch getting deformation, or the masonry over the ring is getting out. Then deterioration in concrete, in steel, and in masonry. Discontinuity, cracks being developed. Here you can see in steel, the fatty cracks are developed. In masonry, clear cracks. Displacements, with these one of them has gone out of the alignment, so it is because of the displacement. Bearings in steel, there can be deformation here also, displacement also. And here the masonry above the arch ring is very clearly evident. Then there is a loss of material in concrete, like spalling, there's a loss of material. In steel, because of excessive corrosion, gone from here. Brick masonry, loss of material. So also, they have given fatty crack, different types of fatty failure defects in steel beware. When we have this kind of member, we can have fatty crack across this longitudinal stiffener. This plate, extra strengthening plate is ending, fatty crack can develop. So all these kinds of possible defects, they have been categorized properly accounted for. Typical defects in arch bridges. Similarly, typical bridges continued. Again, typical defects in concrete bridges, displacement, rotation, translation, loss of in concrete bridges. And then the evaluation process. They have developed an evaluation process based on the defects. The use of the bridge defect catalog and the classification of defects knowledge, whatever knowledge database they have got from there. And then they decide what is the to be given for the bridge. And this rating system is different in different countries. Sweden, like they have got a system of classifying the bridge assessment from 1 to 4 scale, 1 to 3 scale, where 0 is the best, 0 to 3 scale. 0 is the best, is the worst. And Germany, they have got again 1 to 4, 1 is the best, 4 is the worst. Then United Kingdom, 0 to 100 is the best, or 1 to 5 is the best. This is for the condition, sorry, and this is for the overall rating. Now, what they have found that different kinds of noticed in the bridges, they can be because of the lapses during the design, because of the lapses during the workmanship, during construct fabrication, or due to deterioration because of the material degradation in the service life, during the service life of the bridge, or due to the fatigue caused by the heavy train traffic. Four reasons are there for the defects. We will see this slide later on also, and how can we probably take care of these defects while designing the new bridges or while constructing the new bridges, so that they get a long sustainable, they can be a sustainable bridge, and they can live longer than their design life. So the project outcome is basically the guidelines. They developed 4 guidelines within this project. Guideline for inspection and condition assessment of existing railway bridges, and guideline for load and resistance assessment of existing European railway bridges. Then monitoring guidelines for railway bridges, repair and strengthening of railway bridges. What are the advantages of Euro project? The guidelines will definitely help the bridge engineers and managers to locate the correct project guideline to help them with the day-to-day management of the railway bridge. And then the high-level project objective that they set, that they have to try to assess the bridge for a speed of 50 kmph and up to 33. Up to 33 ton. So that was deliberately set.
There was a solution
guidelines.
Solution
the use of guidance will enable some of the bridges to meet the requirements and increases the current typical capacity 60 to 200 speeds and 22.5 tons. Excel should be routinely obtainable. Somebody is
Vinayji, can you mute your mic, please? Vinayji? Ruhi, can you mute Vinayji's mic? I think he's not online. He's probably not listening to this.
After giving this about the project sustainable bridge, which the European Union has taken, I have tried to give some of the procedures that the Indian Railway is following for inspection and maintenance. So annual inspection is done on Indian Railways by assistant engineer, as is being done by the Europeans most of the time. And in this annual inspection is the different parts of the bridge, like foundations and river training works, wing walls, etc. Physically, only visual inspection, and then substructure, bearing bed blocks, then superstructure, girder, steel composite of PSC for any visual defect, and slabs, PSC or RCC. For this, he has to sometimes underside of the bridge also to see if there is some kind of spalling or anything, any other thing like that is developing. Then track and approaches. What is the track and its fittings and all other components, and the condition of approaches. We have got different, we have got specific guidelines for maintaining the bridge approaches also, that no track defect should be there in a length of about 50 meters on either side on the bridge approach. So type and frequency of inspections. The girders in superstructure are inspected by bridge engineer routinely once in a year, and a detailed technical inspection is done after every 5 years, where all the connections, all the rivets of the field connections are tested by a testing hammer, and its looseness is checked. And the individual members are checked for any fatigue crack or any other visible loss of section or corrosion or any other type of pitting, or etc. Proper record in a laid down performer is kept. So detailed inspection of bearing is done by the bridge engineer again, and the cycle is once in 3 years. And during this cycle, they also do the cleaning, complete cleaning and greasing of the bearing, and to make it functional. And now, very recently, we have introduced this special third-party inspection by IITs, NIITs, and other specialized institutions. Wherein we structural bridge is safe from the point of view. So this classification, there is a system of classifying the bridge for sanction and rehabilitation and rebuilding. So after inspection by the different by the AEN and BRI, we assign the bridge number. It is basically the worst number assigned to any of the bridge components. Maybe it is foundation, maybe it is substructure, maybe it is bearing, or maybe it's superstructure, or maybe it is a track. If any of the member is having a very low rating number, condition rating number, so that will govern the overall rating number of the bridge. And based on this overall rating number, if the number is 5, then it is okay, sound condition. If it is 4, then it requires routine maintenance. If it is 3, then it requires some plant repair or strengthening or maybe rebuilding. This is a routine exercise of classifying a bridge identifying a bridge or strengthening. But if because of some reason this is not done and we find the condition has deteriorated further, then we may classify the same bridge as ORN2. Which may have to be replaced or rebuilt or strengthened within a period of 1 year. So that puts a kind of a pressure on the maintenance authorities to take care of the bridge. And ORN1 is very, very rare. It is very urgent case when something all of a sudden happens during monsoons and we find that this bridge is required to be replaced, then we leave everything apart and go for that immediate attention. So there is a separate plan head for bridge for sanction of works in Indian Railways work, and regularly the funds are being allotted to the bridges based on the demands projected. And till the bridge is properly repaired or strengthened or rebuilt, extensive monitoring is being done for which a complete record is kept. So there have been concerns of public regarding some of the old bridges. It was elementary committee on railway bridges. They were surprised to find that so many railway bridges which are more than 100 years of old, and railway does not classify them separately. They follow the same system of rating which they do for the new bridges. But we don't find anything wrong in the existing system, but since it was raised at that, have decided that all those bridges wherein there is some doubt expressed by anybody, we go for a third party structural audit by some specialized institute. Lastly, on Central Railway, we have identified 34 such bridges. Mostly were ROBs, and some of the railway bridges also were undertaken for size. The problem is that we don't find very easily the agencies for doing this job in a professional manner. So we are basically in the process of those institutions for doing this kind of an exercise. This is another problem of vacancies. We have got about 40% of vacancies in the cadre, but whatever we have, elephant system, and we are able to take care of the needs of the system. Now, third-party structure audit, we have a load rating guideline for doing this kind of a audit for all ROVs, especially different special type of configurations and arch bridges, and then assessment of residual fatigue life of steel girder bridges in case of doubt generated during stage-wise systematic analysis, then suggesting extending measures or restrictions. So recently, we have given 10 ROVs, 24 railway bridges, for third-party structure audit, mostly to VNIT Nagpur, VJTI Mumbai, IIT Bombay, and some other consultants. Now, old existing bridges, new type of bridges construction being made. Now, earlier we used to have arch bridges, brick or stone masonry. Now we will see, I would be showing some of the photographs. And these arch bridges, particularly in stone masonry on Central Railway, they have been wonderful. They were requiring almost no maintenance. And even now, some of the old arch bridges, if you see, we be sure about that they can be sustained for another 100 years. I don't know why we have stopped constructing these arch bridges. They are so wonderful. Then ROBs construct in a steel deck, got multiple girders with jack arch spanning, very common. Now in new construction, we are getting bowstring girders, mostly in ROBs and also in railway bridges. Some of the railway bridges have also been constructed for bowstring. Then cable lashes, continuous steel bridges, open web girder welded at joints, and precast PSC slabs and girders. So now we have to see how these bridges, which are of new type, they are to maintain and they are to be taken care of so that they can give us a long service life. Now, the simple principle is maintain the bridge in case we want to sustain the bridges. Now, bridges, some of the existing conventional bridges and new type of bridges which are being maintained by railways, and a few roads also I have tried to cover. So we would be seeing that. This is the Mula Bridge on Manmad Round section. It was constructed in 1878. This is another view of this same bridge. You can see sturdy stone masonry structure. And I have personally inspected this bridge, and I don't see any problem with this structure. And I'm sure this bridge can give you a service life of maybe 100 years. And the special feature of this bridge is that it's a very long serial arches, but they have constructed intermediately two very four piers. I just tried to know what was the purpose of this. So somebody told me that it is basically because if something wrong goes with one arch, then it is a serial arch, since complete bridge will go off. So to stop that, they have decided to provide two intermediate fortress type of piers. So if something happens on this arch, it will be restricted only to this portion of the bridge, and the other remaining two parts of the bridge will remain intact. So this is a wonderful concept which somebody took care at the time of this bridge. So this kind of vision, probably we have to keep for constructing our new bridges which that are coming up nowadays. So this is another view of the wonderful masonry. Now this is another bridge, Cogni Bridge. Again, it's a very sturdy substructure. Even superstructure also is no problem. It's a very well maintained, can be sustained. Although it was constructed in 1915, more than 106 years have already gone. This is Benusal Bridge. Now this is another bridge you see. There is a very interestingly a steel column. And it is also very in a nice condition. It's very well maintained. So basically because of the maintenance, regular maintenance and regular inspection being done, so the bridges can be sustained. This is a road over bridge at Sholapur. It was constructed in 1922, almost. This is a closer view of the same bridge. And this is having basically the stone masonry jack arch. And the condition is quite good. There is no leak. So this bridge also is a very in a very good condition, except that some over layers of the road metal have come over the top of it. So some extra dead load has come. Why this bridge is in a good condition? It can be sustained another for another 30-40 years easily. Now this is a Bhukri bridge on Bhusawal division. You can say it has been modified. The top bracings have been modified subsequently to accommodate the increase in moving dimensions of the trains. So this is the beauty is that you can do some modifications and you can retain the bridge by doing some modifications, and that helps us to sustain the bridge. This is another view of the same bridge. Now this is Tapti bridge. This is very interesting. It was constructed in 1882. So somewhere in 2003, had doubts about its integrity and they were thinking of rebuilding it. But then the auditing was entrusted to IIT Bombay, and what I understood only Professor Pradeepto Banerjee only who did this study, and then he extended the life of this bridge for another 20 years. Now we are in 2021. Now again, this bridge is being entrusted for a further review to IIT Bombay, and hopefully this bridge should give us another service life of another 20 years, I feel. The condition of the super substructure, you can see it's very well. It is actually as good as new, and it can be sustained easily. Now this is the Bhima bridge on Sholapur Wadi Sector. It's a 23 spans of 18.3 meter. And this bridge, we had a problem of top flange getting cracks under the steel channels. We thought of initially there is a need of regirding the bridge. So the total cost was about 30 crores. But later on, we decided to replace only the top plate. Existing 10 mm thick top plate was replaced by 12 mm thick steel plate. And that job was done under the mud blocks on the bridge for the work progress for about 6 months. But then this whole job was completed in less than 2.5 crore rupees. So that way, a huge amount of expenditure on regirding, and the job was completed by a meager amount of 2.5 crores. So this is the same bridge. Now this is Kogni Bridge, Sholapur, 1916. Again, the condition is quite good. And this is a ROB at Mumbra. Now you see, it is 1854 means 46 plus 20, almost 170 years. Another 3 years and it will be 170 years. Yeah, so it is still existing, given for third party audit. And since arches are having a very good inherent strength in it, and I'm sure this bridge should be sustained. We are waiting for the third party audit for this bridge. This is another view of the same bridge. And this is arch bridge on Kalyan-Igatpuri section. It's a very sturdy structure. There's no problem with structure. I think it can be sustained another 100 years. Same bridge, train going off. This is another bridge on Kasara-Igatpuri section. You know, there is a high intensity of rainfall on this. So there is some kind of a grass growth. You can say it is, what is this defect? Contamination defect as per the Europe SB project. So this is taken care of by cleaning and then injecting some kind of a chemical. And then many times we do the CPG also, that is cement pressure grouting, so that all the cavities are filled up. And that is good enough to sustain such kind of bridges. Same bridge, I think. Now this bridge, again near Thane, it is a bowstring type of a girder in concrete. So there had been a history of this bridge. Some repair strengthening has been done earlier. So some of the divisional officers represented that we want to get this audited. They were not getting the confidence, because it's a non-standard kind of an arrangement. So this bridge also we have given for third party, and we are waiting the report. Now this is another 170 years old, 1854 Thane Diva section. Stone masonry arch bridge in a very good condition. Definitely it is going to contain complete 200 years of life. Now this is Jubilee Bridge, 1885, constructed in 1885. This bridge has got a very special type of a bearing, which is called the pendulum bearing. And this bridge had a 79 about this pendulum bearing. See, actually the pendulum bearing was made of cast iron steel. And this link, this pendulum steel, and the whole span was supported on this link through a pin. And then this load was being transferred through this A-frame to the, so it was a very special, unique kind of a design. And the problem was that this central pin, it was passing through a cylinder, and this cylinder had, and it used to be filled with the lubricating oil. So when this cylinder cracked, all the lubricating oil that leaked off, and then the bearing started giving the trouble. And with that condition, with some repairs suggested by RDSO in 1979, this bridge was another 24 years, 25 years. Another problem was reported in 2004. Again, some repair strengthening was done. And then finally, this bridge was replaced up in 2016. So virtually after giving the first sign in 1979, we got about more than 35 years to prolong the service life of this bridge. Now we have got this three-pin steel arch in KV Railway. It's a wonderful bridge. There is hardware on this bridge. So I am sure this bridge can give almost indefinite life. There is no issue with this bridge. This bridge, multiple arch gallery, Kalka Shimla section, very sturdy bridge, except some contamination, no other major issue. So we said a sustainable bridge. And this is a very beautiful bridge, Coronation Bridge. I am surprised why this kind of bridges are not being constructed nowadays. It was the first bridge constructed in a concrete arch with verticals, and almost 80 years have passed, and I don't think then there is any problem. The beauty is that this bridge was completed in about 4 years. It started in 1937 and completed in 1941. And this is a new bridge. Everybody knows signature bridge as Wazirabad. It's a beautiful bridge, very wonderfully designed and constructed. I don't know what is the maintenance of this bridge, because this bridge must be sustained for a very long period of time. For that, whatever maintenance inputs are required to be done, that must be given. Now, new constructions, some more photographs you would like to see. Now, again, the same Jubilee Bridge, a new bridge has come up, which is a continuous span having the LWR also. But since it is in steel, and Indian Railways having a well-defined laid down inspection schedule and maintenance manual, should not be much problem for maintenance of this bridge, and it should be called a sustainable bridge. This is a new bridge coming up at Anji Khat in JN. This is the pylon of this bridge coming up. So we don't have a past experience of maintaining such kind of bridges. So we need to develop an organization of this kind of bridges. It's very important. And this, we had a special lecture also on this bridge, Chenab Bridge. The arch has been completed, but bridge is to be commissioned. And after commissioning, the maintaining of this bridge and accessibility of different parts, and I think it is going to be a huge task. So this is a big challenge, I think. Same bridge. Now this is a bridge which is coming up at Nagpur for Nagpur. And initially we had some issues to approve this type of a construction, because it is segmental construction that is also cast in situ. So doing that over the running tracks was an issue, but later on with the intervention of Railway Board, the doubts were cleared, and we finally decided to go for this kind of a bridge. But this very much similar to the old arch bridges, and once constructed, I don't foresee any major maintenance issues with this kind of a bridge. So this had a sustainable bridge which is being constructed, keeping in view the futuristic requirements of maintenance. And since metro is not having very high load, axle load, so from loading point of view, no issues should come on this bridge. This is another location. It's a tough location where a bridge is coming. There are four tiers of traffic. You see a subway, and then there is railway over that, and over that there is double decker metro. There is a state and then also a metro. So the maintenance of such kind of structures would be posing a big challenge, because something happens on this bridge, it will affect the all the four modes. This is the schematic diagram of this bridge. And this is a photograph of the approach pier, which is coming up. You can see the subway. You can see the subway in the background. And these kinds of hoisting girders are coming up very quick, very, very frequently nowadays on ROB. And we had some issues about the design and then fabrication, but later on, we insisted for either RDOS inspection and then third party inspection of the, and suggested some modifications in the connections to take care of the fatigue effects. And all those things were implemented and finally been constructed in Nagpur. Very good aesthetically, but of course, from maintenance point of view, maintaining this kind of a new design for a very long is a challenge. This is the figure of the same bridge. Now, some of the theoretical aspects, how can we get the benefit from the existing bridges where the coefficient of dynamic augment is, actually this is a very important aspect. When we analyze a existing bridge, we have to see what are the actual loads coming on the bridge. Many times the design loads or design is are not coming on the bridge. Like for example, all the standard spans of RDSO, they are designed with respect to the standard bridge rules. 25 ton loading is mandatory nowadays. And then the design speeds are 165 for passenger trains and 125 for, but you will not find any goods train moving at a speed of 125 or any passenger train to date. I think no train is moving at a speed of 160. So practically, when a bridge is in service, you will find that the damaging effects are much less as compared to the loads for which the bridge has been designed. And at times, the location of the bridge is very near to some big city. Like you see the Delhi, most of the rivers, most of the big cities are by the side of some river. And they are necessary to be crossed when a train has to reach to the main station. So necessarily the train will slow down at the approach. So that speed would be more than 60 or 70. So accordingly, the dynamic augment will reduce. So we can take the advantage of this reduction in coefficient of dynamic and we reassess the bridge for the present day needs. And then there is another fact that used to run our trains with steam locomotives. And steam locomotives, the locomotive was a very, very heavy kind of a rolling stock, and it used to give a hammer blow effect. So that CDA was very, very high. Subsequently, RDSO at some stage of time, somewhere in 1980s or so, have reviewed that CDA, and the new CDA formula is lesser as compared to the old. But the old bridges, they must have been constructed as per the RDA. So one can take the advantage of this fact that the old bridges were designed for a higher CDA value. This is the present day formula of the CDA. This I have already told, speed 160 kmph and 125 goods trains. Now, RDSO had also conducted some studies earlier, somewhere in 1995 or 96. The reports are available, and one can again go for a review of this CDA by actually taking the strain, shear strains or deflections under the moving loads. The loads which are known, and at varying speed, one can move the designated and take the readings of the bending strains, shear strains, and deflections, and work out the relationships. And then one can validate the CDA values. I'm sure some relief is available. So that can help us to reassess and certify the old bridges. Now, there are certain advantages of USO standard spans, which we usually insist that as far as possible, RDSO standard spans should be used. First thing is that designs are validated and available readily for review. So in case is to reassess the bridge for some increased loading, it can easily be done. Then sufficient margins are available while reassessing the higher speeds and axle loads. Because these bridges are designed, the standard spans, they can be put anywhere. So they are designed for maximum load and maximum speed, which may not be existing at a particular location. I have just told about it. Then maintenance strength established, skilled manpower for the same is available. Then staff at the lowest level is aware about the design principle. Like in open web girders, everybody in railways who is in or in bridge organization, he knows that the bottom cord will carry the tension, top cord will carry the compression. So this kind of standardization are definitely very, very helpful. So bridges can be easily qualified to be declared sustainable if they are using standard spans. Now, this is the slide which we have earlier seen in sustainable bridge project observations, that the defects can be during the design. Defects can be during the workmanship, during the construction or during fabrication, and then during the service life or due to the fatigue. Now, how can we take care of these defects not to be there in our new constructions? So just some policy which I thought which can be discussed here, that we must first of all select a conceptual design which is going to be sustainable in itself. Like if you see the case of the Chenab bridge, I know there was a storm brainstorming session to design to decide the conceptual the bridge. So almost all the eminent persons who were knowing about something about the bridge engineering, they were called in Northern Railway, and they decided, they gave decisions, and finally this conceptual arrangement of steel arch with steel columns was decided. So steel bridges are definitely, they are able for any modification, strengthening. Of course, the maintenance cost is more, but are sustainable. And the another advantage is the steel can give its salvage value after, even when it completes its service life, and you want to demolish it, you get some money in demolition. Unlike in concrete, if you demolish, it's a job and you have to pay for this demolition. But in steel, you get the money for demolition. So this is another advantage of using the steel. So design, one has to decide at the conceptual stage what kind of bridge he is making and what is going to be its longevity. So stage-wise design control is necessary. So design basis note is very important actually. If you want a longer life, even after the design life, you want to sustain the bridge, then at the basis note, it stage itself, one must mention all those requirements, okay, what should be done, so that the bridge has got a possibility of extending its life. So specification quality assurance plans are to be made accordingly. It's very important. And construction erection should be as per the method statements which are approved by the design. So if we take care of all these things, probably we would be leaving no scope for any defect to develop because of the design or construction. Then of course we have got inspection schedule, which has to be specified. The critical members, how they are to be inspected, at what frequency it is to be inspected, and how it is to be maintained. And we should provide for the standing arrangement for future needs. Like in steel open web girder bridges, people now can even do the subsequent pre-stressing by providing external cable. Then competent personnel for documentation verification at every stage is very important. Now, some of the policies, instructions which we have issued for new overhead cost Central Railway, which was subsequently circulated by Railway Board to all other railways, was about the safety and reliability of new ROBs, overhead crossing coming over the railway systems, particularly in cities like So these instructions we have issued. I do not know how much people are aware about it and how much they are applying it, but it all those things which are necessary to make new bridges as reliable and sustainable bridges. I will not discuss much about it because it is going to be very detailed, maybe boring. So this is in summary form it is given. It takes care of the design issues, its execution methodology, it takes care of the execution at site, then inspection and maintenance, strengthening measures during service, and then during the delaunching or dismantling. So we had also issued some guidelines for design and proof consultants. Actually, this is a very important thing. Whenever a new bridge is being, it is very important that the bridge owner, consultant, and proof consultant, they all are at the same platform. Quite often, the construction of the bridge get delayed because there are issues which remain unresolved between the consultants, proof consultants, and the bridge owners. So some broad guidelines if you give in the very beginning to all the stakeholders, then probably such kind of delays can be avoided and a very good design can be obtained. So design requirement of design basis, note, geotechnical investigation, start of the design work, and how it has to be reviewed during the different stages. So that helps to expedite the. So now the most important thing about the bridge health monitoring, it has to be a systematic approach, type of bridge and availability of domain knowledge with the person who is doing this work. Then follow a specified system of inspection and maintenance, identification and in critical components, qualified personnel for evaluation of defects, confirmation of strength parameters of material, availability of design documents, interaction with design engineer consultants, and assessment of actual loads. Operational maintenance management of bridges requires that all bridges after design and construction, they pass to the phase of operational maintenance. And this phase starts and opens to traffic, and till the service life is over, this stage continues. Now, demolition replacement occurs when the bridge reaches a minimum acceptable level of performance and when at the same time repair, rehabilitation or strengthening is not economically justified. So there is a stage-wise approach to be taken for bridge health monitoring, which we have also discussed. Doubts, if there are any doubts, then one has to go for detailed inspections. Still there are doubts, then second, then the third stage, we will see it in detail in the next slide. Monitoring guidelines are given by the Sustainable Bridge Project. Then there are investigation performance related. I will skip this, and then I will go for the straight away. This is all things we have discussed. Brief. This is a very important slide. It gives how we have to deal with health monitoring of the bridges. See, there is a bridge management, who are the bridge, or you can say bridge owner. And they are the nodal people. They have to arrange regular inspections. They get the regular feedback of the health of the bridge based on the internal assessment. Regular minor, then they do regular and minor maintenance also. Then structural health monitoring, bridge management is also their job. They decide basically when a bridge is to be repaired, when a bridge is to be rebuilt. And there are external concerns regarding bridge performance, safety, serviceability, durability. And there can be some infrastructure policy, mandatory requirement from some government department or government instructions. And there can be some external factors like higher loads and speeds, increased traffic volume, which are to be run. Keeping in view all these things, the bridge management has to decide whether it has to go for a special inspection, a special assessment of the bridge health or structural health monitoring. So the doubts are created because of all these three factors. And these doubts are to be addressed initially by simple study, which may include a site visit or study of the design drawings or other design documents and simple calculation checks whether with the increased loads or increased speeds, whether the existing design, existing bridge can be sustained, can be found safe, yes or no. If yes, then there is nothing required to be done. Continue the use of the bridge. If there is doubt, then they go for a detailed analysis. Again, actual assessment of the load depending upon the location of the bridge and actual condition of the material, and then some simple other observations. Based on the compliance with respect to codes and regulations, if it is there, nothing is required to be done. Update the maintenance and continue the use of the bridge. If the compliance of codes and regulations is not there, then simple repairs is done, it solves the problem. If yes, then do that and then continue with the bridge. If no, then go for a enhanced refined calculations, maybe laboratory examinations, statistical modeling, reliability based assessment, economical design, decision analysis, etc., etc. And if you find sufficient capacity is there, then again continue with the bridge, update the maintenance, continue. If no, then you have to take a decision. This is the special stage of decision making. You have to read the bridge, or you have to go for a continuous health monitoring of the bridge, or you have to do the strengthening of the bridge, or both, or you have to finally, if nothing is possible, then finally decide for going demolition of the bridge and constructing a new bridge. So this approach is a very, very reasonable, rational based approach, a systematic approach, which I say, we take care of about our health. If we find some symptoms about our own health, we go for a OPD. First of all, telephonic consultation, if necessary, a physical meeting with the doctor. And then if doctor says, no, you are having some problem, you have to be admitted, we go for a admission. Then ICU is a last stage. We should not straight away jump to the instrumentation, which many people try to do in railways. So this is an aspect of structural health monitoring. One must keep in view this stage-wise health monitoring of the bridge. So now what is the future? We have to have increased association with educational institutions so that this knowledge about the bridge health monitoring and sustainable bridges reaches to each and every bridge. Knowledge creation through them and sharing for overall growth and better inspection and maintenance methods. Developing practical guidelines for performance evaluation and monitoring in Indian context. Then approved list of consultants for third-party performance evaluation. And full-fledged Institute of Health Monitoring of old and important bridges and training of bridge engineers. If possible, that would be a very good thing for the whole country. Now, what are the essential requirements? Probably one thing is very long pending, I think, is the Professional Engineers Bill. I have been listening about it for the last 10 years. And best of my knowledge, the draft is reportedly under preparation. It needs to be accelerated. And we probably need bridge engineering at BTEC and MTEC level. Is very essentially required. So with this, I finish my presentation. Thank you very much for a very patient listening. I hope I have not exceeded the time limit.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Goel sir. It was really very, very, very nice lecture. Informative, in fact, lots of points you had covered. So thank you for the detailed presentation. On sustainable bridges, policies, issues, design, health monitoring of bridges. Thank you, sir. After this, we will have one sponsored presentation, which is given by Machine Sense. It will be a 15 minutes presentation. And it will be presented by Mr. Sudip Muzumdar. So after this presentation, we'll have question answer. The question answer will be handled by Swapnil Joshi. So I would request Mr. Sudip Muzumdar to take over.
Before that, just a minute. Actually, yeah, please, meanwhile, I was in writing. So I request the participants, whosoever are having the questions, they must put their questions in question and answer box. I would try to give the answers in writing. However, it is not possible to give in writing. I will give it verbally after this presentation by Mr. Sudeep Majumdar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Yeah, over to Mr. Majumdar. Welcome.
Thank you very much for welcoming me. It was a wonderful presentation, Mr. Goyal. You actually showed us what India is in terms of engineering excellence in the Marvel, etc. But few things actually, you know, came to my mind is in terms of, though I'll be covering that in terms of the way things are today and what could be tomorrow. Sorry, that is my presentation. But before just getting into that, let me just introduce myself a little bit. I was the digital head of L&T for 4 years before my current stint, and I'm currently I co-chair the ASSOCHAM's National Council for Digitalization for Tunneling and Safety. Underground Construction. It's on the safety side. That's one. It's my passion. Actually, I'm a civil engineer, postgraduate from IIT, and post-graduation from University of Michigan, Ross Business School. So that's what my journey is. Good news is I've got actually Dr. Biplab Pal, IIT Kharagpur, physics and PhD from Kharagpur itself. And he's actually one of the co-founders of this company. And he's also in the, he's also present in this presentation. So I will just start my presentation. I'll take 15 minutes only. This is a kind of a snapshot, but we can always go into the detail at the later point in time. So let me just bring up my presentation for slide, which is, if you can see it, if you can let me know, please. You can see it, right?
Yes, we can see, sir.
Thank you. Let me just minimize this. So it's a structural health monitoring. Obviously, you talked about Mr. Goyal from post-construction structural health monitoring bridge health system. But we are very specific at this point in time here in this presentation. But I must tell you just few things that, you know, we are trying to in this process, especially when we are engaging with multiple universities abroad, and we are based out of US Center in Calcutta as well, Software Development Center, and we will talk about those innovation also in between, not too much because of the time paucity. So first of all is thank you, Obove, actually, who gave me this statistics, and since the public information, I'm kind of using it, which is 170,000 major bridges, which is basically, again, we are talking about the concrete side, and 21,000 bridges possibly as a deficient, maybe give and take, and around 3,000 bridges possibly worse than deficient. I don't know how we are classifying. Now, those are, that's we're talking about the numbers, so bridges, statistics, etc., right? And what are the things that we monitor today? To your presentation also again, Mr. Goyal, because you just gave a fantastic presentation. So typically we look at the cracks, we look at the rusting, we look at the subsidence, breakages, deflections, property. Though I haven't seen the elastic property, but I assume that elastic property also you look at. Now, during construction also various tests you do, we could see that very easily. And some of the things believe that something can be done, and we'll talk about it. Now, obviously required skilled equipment and request skills as well as equipment necessary. Another thing that we look at, the parts of bridges are difficult to access, that we see that all the time. Remote monitoring is the key, because many of the bridges that you showed, basically it's there, even inspection. So, we are not talking about too much on the drones today, usage of drones, but since I have a background of L&T, I know that how much drones actually we have been using, and most they're using drones commercially, yeah, with their certified pilot. So current monitoring is basically, if I look at, it's most of them are, right? And I know that, many companies, because I worked with some of the companies myself. So most of the things are visual, electrical, mechanical, instrument there, of course, instrumentation is there because a lot of sensors are there, strain gauges are there, typically, if you look at the moment I talk about strain gauge there, remote area, earlier we used to have some kind of storage at the site, and we had a lot of problems in communication, etc. And another very important thing is that, discrete data put in the Excel and do the pivots or do some kind of mechanism to understand what is the deflection, what is the elastic property, which are absolutely fine. I mean, even today also, this is needed. Visual checks, as I said, drones is basically human. We are substituting human by flying a drone or, you know, finding some kind of LIDAR and get the data and do the analysis with the software actually sitting in there, sitting in one place. You don't, you know, take entire stuff. Similarly, mechanical, electrical, I talked about. So there are ways of doing it. It's, we believe that it's, you know, it is absolutely needed. It's not completely can overcome. But at the same time, we need to look at the new world approach. New world approach is basically IoT, or I would say IIoT, industrial IoT. Basically, it's a lots of different kinds of sensing. We'll talk about it, what we do on that. Lots of different kinds of sensors. What does sensor do is basically takes the data about the bridges of different kinds, and depending on what kind of with a sensor, whether it's a simple GPS sensor, I'm talking about whether it's accelerometer, whether it's a tilt sensor, whether it's deflection sensor, all different types of sensors. We'll talk about it. Another very important thing is for the old world and new world. We talked about database storage at the side, but we are talking about today cloud, and we are talking about embedded chip, edge computing, probably 1,000th of the size, but at the same time, within that we have a sensor, and it has got a storage, which has got a CPU to calculate. We can actually push analytics at that storage, at that sensors in the site, where nobody has to go there. Only thing I need the communication, right? And artificial intelligence, we don't talk about much as we associate these days. I'll talk about one or two things that what we are doing through AI and ML and DL also, which is basically continuous monitoring. If you look at the discrete data, it has given way to continuous monitoring, 24/7, sub-second data. This is a very important thing. We'll give you obviously a point, and we may argue that whether it's required or not, but yes, there are something that we may show it to you that how much required they are. So this is why continuous monitoring is important. If you look at seismic zone monitoring, can you do a discrete data? We'll have to do a seismic zone monitoring with a very much continuous data. So you need a seismic storage. You need to analyze the size of the bridge. You'll have to net, we need to do a net deflection of, or net subsidence of a bridge, girder, of a bridge element, net of seismic subsidence, right? So it's a combination of huge volume of data. It's a combination of huge volume of data of multiple things and analyzing analytics, right? It is not just simple, just a pivot from Excel. And another important thing is the prediction. This is the next new frontier that we'll, if there is a signature, what is a bridge signature? Let's say today we are commissioning a bridge. There is a signature. If there is no load, there is a signature, meaning there will be a profile of, you know, load and deflection. And if we start commissioning on the bridge, that means the vehicle starts, there will be, let's say for a month, we observe and we get a day zero signature or a month one signature. After 2 years, we look at it, 4 years, we look at 20 years, the signature will be different. Now, what is a signature? I'll talk about it later. So prediction is very important element that we need to bring on. You know, you are doing a prediction also, as you said, you know, one of the bridges, I think Tapti Bridges talked about that, Professor Banerjee went there, he gave a certificate of 20 years on. But I think, you know, between these 20 years also, we need to monitor. So triaxial deflection, this is another important thing, X, Y, Z axis, all three axis deflection, not only a Z axis deflection. Now that's basically it for us, you know, how we are looking at it for the old world to the new world. Now, who are we? The company we have, Machine Sense, is a Baltimore-based company, Maryland, US. Another software delivery center, which is in Kansas City. And we have got it in India, in Kolkata as well. It is actually, Machine Sense is founded by another historic personality's great-grandson, Conrad Bessemer. Possibly you'll be knowing, we talked about steel. Steel founder is Henry Bessemer. Right, scientist who had 200 patents in his name. Conrad is actually Henry Bessemer's great grandson, and so he is one of the founders. Dr. Biplab Pal, he's a big guy from IIT Kharagpur. A lot of design actually he has done by himself, And we do have, actually, we can boast of it that we only take masters and PhDs in our team. Dr. John Hunt, another, you know, computer science kind of, I would say, wizard. He did a lot of great work and different other companies. He's actually US defense advisor as well. And he's another person who is actually changing the architecture, doing it better all the time. So this is a kind of a profile. This is very important why we are talking about it, because in fact, as we speak, actually, we are trying to recruit from the PhD from IIT Kharagpur, ready to go to IIT Bombay or any other IITs as well. So because we think that this is an area where actually we can make a difference. So that's where we are. We'd like to really confluence of civil engineering, construction world, and the computer science world. You know, though I, you know, in the afternoon we were talking, I was a kind of a little bit, you know, we were kind of, but it's important both as CE, and it's time that we need to converge. In fact, my experience in L&T with a lot of experts in this area, Mr. Rakesh Chopra was a railway board member. In fact, I have spent a lot of time with him to understand what's happening. Professor Bongirwar, Professor Goel, Professor Goel in IIT, Siddharth, Professor Dang, all are in IIT KGP. So we actually keep talking to them and try to understand this area more, develop, and basically we will be improving upon whatever we know today. Now coming back to that, what we do actually refer to final analytics and showing it on the computer and on the mobile. So from end to end. Now, why you talk about this is very important thing, because many of the providers today in the market are basically taken from the market. Today, we are in a position, we can tell you that we have a sensor manufacturing center in Baltimore as well as in Kolkata. Are all PhDs, and they actually design these sensors and we manufacture these sensors. We have people who have been in a career of semiconductor sensors and this area. So if you look at the three-axis deflectometer, or if you look at, you know, whatever the sensors you can see, most of them actually are designed by us, manufactured by us, embedded software is also provided by us, most of them. Yes, in some cases, we do take some of the chips from market, because we do work with some of the big chip maker as well, but I'm not going to the names of that. But important is you get end-to-end solution from us. Whatever you said today, or whatever we discussed today, that if you want to look at the health monitoring, which is basically very example you gave, that, you know, if you want to know that whether heart is doing good or not, I'll have to put an ECG. ECG does a curve and of the deflection or whatever the stuff is, we get to understand and where the heart is. Very similar to that, our job. And we believe that we are going to be the doctors of the, you know, the bridges. So another important thing is that I would say that, you know, triaxial deflectometer, we talked about it. Most of the deflection, in fact, again, even in my L&T days also, I had a lot of debates with the designers and with the project directors and very senior people they are. And we always see that, you know, it's a Z-axis deflection, but we are talking about here X, Y, Z, all three deflection. And this is very important for us to understand that we believe and we have seen some of the failures, not in the Z direction, actually it's X and Y direction, probably in the Y direction more, right? And we have seen the failure in Calcutta where the bridge guard toppled because there was a, you know, 40 tonner going at 60 kilometers per hour speed in the night, and this entire thing topped. There was a problem with the bridge bearing itself. So we look at the bearing, we look at the deflections, etc. Now, and the important thing is that how do you do it? Now, most of the sensors you'll be seeing that is post-flexion, right? Here, we are actually using magnetic principles with the rate of change of flux. And we approach through AI on that. The rate of change of flux minus the, you know, rate of change of flux is going to give you the deflection, XYZ deflection. And that should be netted compared to the seismic deflection. And all these actually work are extremely mathematics driven. And that's what we do. And that's why our PhDs are. So that's what we are doing. So, you know, we can go up to, typically we can go up to 10 micron deflection, but we have seen that 100 micron is okay. So this is the kind of work that we are doing, very high-tech work, which will be really needed in the civil engineering world, right? Now, where did we do? Actually, we have done it in the US as well. We've got a partnership with multiple companies because you know what? Seeing that in this area, there are few companies who are doing fundamental work, who are developing themselves. It is not about just, you know, getting a sensor, fitting it there. The big important thing is not only having the solution, but also fitment, installation, monitoring, and there is some human behavior also, cutting the wire, et cetera, et cetera. Those are all part of it. We don't see that world that much, but obviously we have seen it in my experience, and again in L&T, I've seen that, right? But important is get the solution correct first, from the sensor to the software side, right? And to do that, there are brilliant people working. And we must say that you know, we are good at it, and there are good people as well in the market. And we are a good kind of consortium, actually, across US and transatlantic as well. And we are working with Airbus at this point in time. We are working with some other companies which have got mutual strengths. Now, what we are doing is here very simple. The deployments that we are talking about mostly in Kolkata that we are doing, because we are very closely working with the bridge committee in
and only 2 minutes are left out, please.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll do that. So there's a, you know, it's a quite a few bridges that actually we are working on, and we have installed there. And what we are doing is very simple. Installation means not only installation in terms of the sensors, etc. What we are doing is we are getting the data, very simple, and we also validating it through cameras, etc. You know, when there is a load, we see that, you know, what kind of load is there, and we try to correlate between the. And if you see that in the T1, T2, T3, that's what we are talking about. It's basically the blue line is a T1, which is basically the, because the load, it has gone down and has come up to the particular position, but it has not gone to the position. See that, because possibly there was another load. So one is the deflection. Second one is we actually look at this deflection and the elastic property as well. T2 and T3 is basically, you know, today and possibly 2 years later, possibly 4 years later. So how this curve goes, and we have seen that after 2 years, this kind of phenomenon. I can't just do it completely here. It's important that, you know, this is XYZ, all three axis deflection versus, you know, what we are getting, the vibration of the earth. So it's basically two things we are trying to map, the deflection as well as vibration. Deflection because of the vibration, as well as vehicular deflection. I mean, the deflection because of the vehicle load. So deflection happens not only for the vibration of, also vibration of the, or also the load. So all these things are basically correlated. We are trying to correlate. So if you look at the top, so which we are going to the future, because I know that I've got only 30 seconds. So correlations between the load deflection of the three axis. This is very important. Load and deflections, recovery time, elastic property. Elastic property is a clear sign of the weakness of the concrete, right? And the correlation analysis between seismic deflection. This is another thing that basically we are doing mathematically. Now, what we are going to do tomorrow is a last two bit, which is you're talking about the materials test results, but there is no way during construction test results we are looking at after 20 years, 10 years, 5 years also, that whether they are anywhere responsible or not to the bridge elastic property. These are the things actually for the future, right? So combined advanced analytics, that is the order of the day that we'd like to do. Of course, data-driven approach is absolutely, and vehicle density, environmental effects, like salinity, temperature, the difference in temperature in a day, all these things are part of, and the seismic vibration, they say, you know, all these are part of the bridge health. And we'd like to combine them and to understand and predict the behavior of the bridge. That's what the future is. Thank you. If you have any question, maybe some other day. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vishal Dhumne. Give me a minute. Hello,
yeah,
Dr.
Please.
Vishal Dhumne. Let me thanks to Mr. Raju Majumdarji. And during your 15 minutes of lecture, we have internally discussed with our EC meeting, executive committee meeting, and we request you for 18, we'll have your a full-fledged lecture on the health monitoring of the bridges. So we request you, if you are available on 18th June, 6:30 to 9 o'clock. from your senior colleagues or who can present a talk, so we can continue. I'm sorry, I was a little tough on the time part. I'm sorry, it's a duty.
Absolutely no problem, Gopal. This is our pleasure, and you will be getting another chance to. We'd like to change the world. That's what together we will be doing. Thank you very much. Any question later on, you can send it to me. My number is there with you guys.
But yeah, so we'll again hear this same subject, but in an elaborate way to June, 6:30 p.m. to 9 o'clock, and we'll have international speaker, Dr. Biplab Pal. Yeah, I think he's the president for the machine. So the audience don't curse it and don't get disappointed that we have rushed in between. So this was just a trailer. You will get a major things. Over to you, I think, Dr. Mumre. Let us start the panel discussion and all that part. Vishal, over to you.
Thank you. Yeah, Mr. Sunil Mazumdar, what a good presentation. And thanks to Dr. Gopal, he has engaged him in a very short duration time. So we'll have a detailed discussion on it. Before panel discussion, we'll have question answer session. So I would hand it over to Dr.
Dr. Thomre. Let me request, it's my pleasure to invite the today's panelist. Professor, our Guru, Professor Pradita Banerjee, sir. Professor, over to you. I think bas aashirwad rakhiye, sir, on IIB.
From a panel discussion point of view, what is this thing? Is it about the topic today, or is it
about... Yeah, it was about the engineer R.K. Goyal's topic. Yeah. You have to
mention, I think, what we got in this entire presentation, an hour 15 minutes from Mr. Goyal, was the current state of EU, and maybe what is possible in India. And of course, then we kind of jumped gaps to having IoT enabled this thing that Mr. Sunil Mazumdar talked about. And I think it's very important to understand that it's a continuum. It is not this or this, okay? That it's a continuum, and it is very important to understand that what the stakeholders need, okay? Very often get involved in is the interesting bits of information that comes from bridges. We have to be very important understand that what does every stakeholder have in this? For example, the bridge owner needs very simple answer. The answer is my bridge safe or not? Okay, if it's not safe, what do I do about it? Okay, can I strengthen it or do I need to demolish it? So I think that's what, Mr. Goyal was very pertinent to point out. What happens today is that especially in academics and in the company, we get involved in the data, okay? All of that. And while data is very, very important, the question remains, is my bridge safe? If it's not safe, can I fix it to demolish it? Or retrofitted economically. This is something that we need to, and this is where today, for example, new materials come into the picture. A lot of new materials can actually be used to strengthen existing bridges to perform both retrofit as well as strengthen. And I think that is something that is vital to new materials. How do we bring in new materials? And if we're bringing in new materials, before we bring in, and that's where I think Mr. Goyal also talked about it, and it's very important that new materials should not be brought in to practice directly. There needs to be significant research activity on the performance of the new material, all of these kinds of things. These are things that need to be done, and which is why, and I think Mr. Goyal, as well as Mr. Mazumdar was talking about it, how we need all the different stakeholders, the bridge owners, the so-called experts, the so-called academia, academia research, all of these have their roles to play and they need to work together in India. I think that's very, very important. Thank you.
Professor, actually, there was one question which was there. As you are a director of IIT Roorkee also, I think Goyal sir has requested ask for the M.Tech and courses in bridge engineering.
By the way, there are existing at the B.Tech level, maybe not, but at the M.Tech level, definitely, at least I know of two, IIT Bombay and IIT Roorkee, there are bridge engineering courses. There's a course called Bridge Engineering, where you actually look at, from the design perspectives to, the end, how to replace, when to replace, all of those questions. So there are courses of bridge engineering already exist. The question is, something that Mr. Goyal talked about, and this is something that I have an issue with. And that is that, let's say railways, since Mr. Goyal represents the railways, okay? What happens is there is no dedicated bridge engineering cadre. I've actually had significant discussion with the railway board that, bridge engineering cadre does not exist. So what happens is, someone is looking at bridges, then they move on to look at something else, so that knowledge that is gained, by someone. I mean, Mr. Goyal is possibly extremely rare in the railway system because since he's worked in the Bridges and Standards Directorate at RDSO for a very long time, he also looked at bridges at the lower level, and even then he looked at CBE. But today he's no longer CBE, and that I think is a big thing that his knowledge. This bridge carter is a very, very important aspect. And this, by the way, it doesn't exist in the highways. It does not exist in the railways. The bridge carter is at an expert level, needs to be brought into place somewhere.
Thank you, Professor, for your feedback and towards the
discussion part. Can I give a brief comment, please, Dr. Gopal?
Yes, sir. Please. Yes, sir.
What Professor Banerjee wants to say is, even if you train the people at B.Tech level or say M.Tech level, then what is their career prospects? Where do they find the job? If there is no cadre in a department, government departments, or there is no job opportunities, then what they will do with that degree? That is his point. So that is a very important issue which has come up. So we have to take a holistic approach, and then we have to see ultimately whatever whosoever is getting graduation or the M.Tech degree, he should get some job prospects in the system. That is the important point. Thank you, sir.
Now let me have our senior most, from the government department, IPL Bongiwar sir. Let me have a quick comment from him. Bongiwar sir, can you give a quick comment on the presentation done by R.K. Goyal? I think sir is there or not?
Yes, it was a very good presentation, and basically the problem with the railway, the replacement of the new bridge construction is almost very difficult because due to the diversion, it's not like our road bridges where the problem is much simpler. So this is the basic challenge, and we have to do some better monitoring system so that the action to replace bridge or action can be initiated much earlier. That is the fundamental issue.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Let me take a quick review from SK Puri sir, Engineer SK Puri sir.
Thank you. I think, I will like to say something about the degree, whether it's BTEC or Masters in Bridge Engineering. Even in our Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, we used to have a different directorate, Bridge Directorate and Roads Directorate. And in mid-90s, it was clubbed together. You see, before that, whenever there was any issue anywhere in the country with any, whether consultant, contractor, or PWD, they used to approach the ministry for advice and, specialized design requirements. And ministry was able to do. But unfortunately, since that directorate has been now clubbed, so, you hardly find in the government department anywhere good bridge engineers or good structural engineers. They are only now available with the consultants. So my take on this, even with the practical experience, what we are finding that when we have to look for structural or bridge engineers for site teams, they're very difficult to get good structural engineers with experience. And with more and more longer span bridges coming up with 100 meter span, 200 meter span, long 1 kilometer bridges, I think it is time that we have dedicated engineers who graduate in civil, in structural and bridge engineering, and as well as MTech, so that we have these specialized experts for future. Because I think I cannot say the number, but it is maybe not in thousand, in lakhs, those bridges will require reconstruction the next 20, 30 years. So we really need a dedicated, expertise in this. So that is what I would like
thank
to
say.
Thank you, sir. This is Pradeepta Banerjee. You're talking to a person whose father was in the erstwhile Ministry of Shipping and Transport Roads Wing, and he was part of the Bridge Directorate, which does not exist anymore today, as you say.
Yeah, you're right. It is somehow unfortunate for whatever reasons, but it's a fact now. And at present, I am handling about 12 projects as authority engineer or independent engineer. And we are really finding that very difficult to get good bridge engineer with experience at site. So according to me, it is required. Because, when I did my BTEC from IIT Delhi in 1972, even at that time I did my master's in structures. That means 40, 50 years back, I had a feeling that you need structural engineers. But over the time, somehow it has, people are more interested in road works or some other works rather than in bridge design. But we need them now. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Let me take our president, Vinay Gupta ji. Engineer Vinay Gupta ji, quick feedback words. Yes, sir.
So I will not like to speak very much on the lecture that we heard, because it is definitely a class by itself. On that, of course, only one comment that Mr. R.K. Goyal has applied all his tactics and all his expertise in condensing 124 slides in almost 1 hour. And I think he has conveyed what he wanted to say very nicely, very nicely. I could gather most of it. So friends, as I said, as I wanted to say rather, IIB is not only keen on bridge engineering or not only keen on bridge design and dissemination or new bridge construction, but also health monitoring, which is an integral part of bridge engineering. Because you may have designed the best bridge, but it has to be monitored through, of course, as we call it, health monitoring. And we have all these experts which you who you have seen just now. Only one thing we have to worry about, of course, when we talk of bridges which are not railway, I would say other disciplines like other sectors like highway sectors and all that, that the bridge data must be collected. The health monitoring data and the inferences must be drawn and collected properly. Many a times when I have seen that certain instruments are left in the structure, the present day health that you check with the previous health to know where the graph is going. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. A quick comment from our DG Director General Devte sir towards the lecture of RK Goyalji. Sir, I think you are muted.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Very nice presentation by Engineer R.K. Goyal as well as Mr. Mazumdar. Very nice and educative presentations. As R.K. Goyal has brought out issues, policy issues and maintenance monitoring issues, those have to be followed very seriously in the railways always. And the latest technology which Mr. Mazumdar has brought out, I think that will be helpful to monitor remote methods. So we should try to follow this latest technology. Thank you both the presentations. Thank you everybody.
Thank Engineer V.N. Hegde sir. A quick comment from you, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Roy, thank you very much. First of all, for giving me an opportunity to speak on the. Well, sir, I think you have today spelled out the secrets of the longevity of the all the railway bridges. all of us have come to know railway bridges are longing for, you know, 100 to 200 years. It's not just, you know, 60 to 70 years or 100 years lifetime for which we designed for. It's exception, I should say. And what was most important and impressive for me is you have demonstrated by your presentation that the arch as a form for the bridges is the most sustainable structural form. And that is quite natural to me, because if you really look at the arch, especially as well as other arches, even the, for that matter, the steel and concrete arches, arch are, you know, like the having the structural components, which is predominantly from the axial forces, not to the flexural forces. Whether it's the actually tension forces or the actually compressive forces. The flexure is not there. As such, even when you are tension, normally you tension members are designed in such a way that it is not subjected to the modulus of rupture. You know, it's within the modulus of rupture. So the question of can't arise at all. I think you are so beautifully brought out. And I was very surprised and very intrigued that these art forms have been lasting for more than 100 years, many of the art bridges which you have shown. And I think there is a lesson to be learned from all from this for all of us, all of we bridge engineers. That's what I feel. And I also just wanted to know from you, and these art bridges had what kind of foundation, whether these are the open foundations. And because even for the same bridge, just parallel to that bridge, nowadays we are going up to the depth of around 30 to 40 meter well foundation as well as the pile foundations, you know, even suppose you park it just beside this bridge, which are going to be there. I don't know how these bridges have been surviving. I'm sure these arch bridges would be having an open foundation maybe around 7 to 8 meters. I don't think it will be more than that, but I think I'll be very happy to be enlightened about it. And you have very, very well sort of cautioned all of us to be, you know, like to be careful about the time untime tested bridges, especially for the railways, whether it's the cable stay very long arch bridges where the maintenance manual have to be yet developed, you know, like by the railways. These are all not the time tested for the railways. This, you know, these are coming out recently, and you have brought it out very well, and you are cautioned in a way. I can see that, you know, like that. For this, that to decide what kind of manuals. You also showed the signature bit also, you know, saying that it has to be maintained well. We'll have to bring out the maintenance manual and make sure such bridges for more than 100 years in the design time. One last point I just want to make, and the bridges which have been designed by the railways lasting for 150 to 200 years, why do we require the structural health monitoring system? I'm not understanding. If the bridges are designed such a way that if it can last for 100 years, like the arch bridges which has been there, and maybe the structural health monitoring is required to detect the, you know, failure, which is that safeguard this failure will not happen, not from the maintenance point of view, perhaps. I do not know. I would like to be sort of enlightened by that, because your bridges are lasting for more than design lifetime. Basically, it has already given its service life. And the problem in India, as far as the structural health monitoring system is, we have and designed structural health monitoring for many of the bridges. Cable stay bridges, say for example, Naini Bridge also have the system, and the signature bridge, which has been done recently for the Delhi, it has the structural health monitoring system. But once that is installed, after 2 or 3 years, nobody is there to look after it. And you know, like that, all the reading thing which is coming, nobody is there to look after that. I think perhaps management of that structural health monitoring system, once it is installed, I think it has to be looked into very carefully. It has to be made sure that it is being monitored, and the data which has been collected is made use of for the purpose, whatever the purpose it is, you know, that the data has been collected. This is what I would like to say, and I would like to have your comments on my observation. Goyal sir.
Can I answer, sir?
Yes.
Yes.
First of all, about the Arch Bridges Foundation, what you have said. On Central Railway, most of the time, if you go slightly deeper, you will get the fantastic rock to found the bridges. Except a few locations are Blackwater Swiles in Bhusawal Division or so. But mostly you will get the good rocky strata to found those bridges. So, and is that in Central Railway, you have got very easy availability of basalt rock. So Dakkin trap basalt, it's a very good rock. And most of the bridges which have been constructed, or even the piers of stone masonry, they are from this basalt. So the bridges are absolutely correct. There is really some problem of leaching of mortar at some places, and our people are expert in giving the treatment. This is what you call cement pressure. The techniques developed, standard methods are developed, people do that, and they can sustain these substructures. The substructure and foundation is fortunately on Central Railway, there is not much problem. Except if there is a Blackwater soil, and people I have gone earlier also for well foundations. So most of the arches you will find on open foundations, and you have rightly said 8 meters is too deep. I think 4-5 meters may you get rock. So second question is about the structure health monitoring you have asked. So my whole emphasis had been right from the very beginning, then structure health monitoring does not mean the action. Structural health monitoring means a gradual step-by-step procedure to examine the health of the bridge and to take the necessary measure in tune with the problems that you are facing. People quite often, in the name of structural health monitoring, they go for instrumentation straight away, which is not required actually, which you want to say also. In fact, in railway also, mostly jo structural health monitoring hum logo ko lagani pad rahi hai, wo naye type ke bridges mein lagani pad rahi hai, jo ki hamare yahan traditional tarike se nahi bane hain. केबल स्टेट ब्रिज फ्लड की पता नहीं क्या होगा. सो दे फिगर बेटर है कि यू सम पुट समबडी हु कैन कीप ऑन मॉनिटरिंग एंड देन ही इज रेस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर दिस बिकॉज फॉर टेकिंग द रेस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी वन हैज टू बी सफिशिएंटली एबल देन ओनली यू कैन टेक द रेस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी. So to avoid, to they create the intermediate that put up somebody who can be responsible for the health monitoring. In the traditional bridges, you arch bridges, mein, what you will do with the Eastern SHM? Hardly any scope. Thank okay. you. I hope I yeah. have replied.
I think expert Dr. Harshvardhan Subbarao, sir. Over to you, sir. I'm sorry. Yeah, I always
thank you. You know, that's fine. Ravinder, thanks very much for a most important display. It raises in mind a few issues which are at policy level which simply get ignored. Whilst we can vacillate on all these issues, the real issue is policy change, which is never forth. The government doesn't see it as a need to address sustainability in its percept at all. It gives prefunctionary approaches and casual approaches. But there is no bridge project in India which truly has a well-audited a carbon credit rating or a CO2 equivalent measurement asseted, and which is does on the one hand of measurable sustainability indices. On the other hand, you have the most sustainable form, which again was alluded to about arch. Yes, of course, arch bridges are definitely sustainable, as Venkat said about it being a pure tension and a compression type system rather than without any bending. That is fine. But then clearly is the minister the other day in one of the events I was comparing, Nitin Gadkari minister, union minister, suggested that there is a cartel of concrete and steel manufacturers, and he wants to teach them a lesson. These were his words, and that they have cartelized and they're charging very high rates. Now, here is a form of arch session, which is simply not practiced or taught anymore in India. It's a shame. I mean, I would say that is a shame. The form of simple masonry arch, which is taking 32 load, for which was never even dreamt of in design 100, 200 years ago, it is still able to sustain. So that is sustainability of the highest level. Forget about being measured or otherwise. That is what you taught us today. You know, what is sustainable? The fact that you get very much more out of it than you had ever even dreamt of, first step. Second step, it is taking augmented axle loads. I mean, that itself is a huge, huge thing addressing sustainability. Not even a matter of normal design life. It is beyond that. You know, it's beyond the call. I think these are issues which we are yet to truly accept. Most important, I come back to you again and again, that there is no tender document which measures sustainability on the trip. As on built, there is no birth certificate for the structure ever given. There's an excellent FIB document on this in which I was developing birth and rebirth certificate of concrete structures. So this concept of birth certificate in no one bridge, which is more than 5 year old, I can get even one drawing. I'm not talking about railway. I'm talking about road stock. And invariably, even if they are, you will get 50%, you will not get 100% of the drawings. And this is age where from 1970, at least, every bridge being built could have been cataloged digitally. That catalog of digital is where we lack. Okay, so then we get into the need to them. If you had all the data set to start with, baseline data at birth, all your NDT, all your signatures, all that if you had at birth, even if you didn't, can you give me the design and drawings? They're not available. So this is the condition under which we are functioning. Addressing sustainability is a far percept in my view. Unless the changes happen, unless the tender documents are completely changed to ensure that sustainability, measurable sustainability is part of the project. And unless we start to train bridges as the cadre of bridge engineers in sustainability, I see this as a far cry. The only thing we do, we can seek solace is that we are directly by increasing longevity, by increasing functionality, by not condemning a bridge up front, by using newer tools that we have developed like probabilistic methods of assessment out of the structure. These may be discovering the hidden reserves and getting more out of the structure. These may be adding to the life, maybe adding to the sustainability thereof. Direct measurement of sustainability simply not.
I have yet to see a document or an IRC guideline or a good Bureau of Indian Standards guideline on these matters. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Thank you, sir.
These are issues. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think RK Goyal ji, you can take one or two questions, okay, which are there. I think it's a sweet comment and encouraging. I think you are becoming a role model for all the young engineers, and you can take a lead because the bill engineers bills. And one question which I think we should take it is like, because of short of time, I think this is Anurag Kumar. Goyalji, you can take that, whether any maintenance guideline for maintenance of bowstring bridge other than available steel structure guidelines?
Actually, this is my biggest resistance. Except this bowstring girder was this only, that we do not have a definite inspection instruction and a maintenance guideline for this kind of a bridge. So problem is that conceptually, if you see, this bridge is similar to a open web girder bridge where verticals are there but the diagonals are missing.
Okay.
So if you design a bridge and you want to take full advanced material strength, then the axial members, they take the full, they give you the full advantage of the material strength, because every part of it or every part of is it in compression. But in bending, if you see, you get a triangular type of a distribution. So you get 50% of the material utilization. Here in this case, are basically just to maintain the distance between the two. Top arch is basically taking all the load and it is getting transferred to this. So, and what you are doing, you are, in fact, there is a lot of welding in this type of a design, which weld I do not prefer because they can give you enough warning. They can be sudden failure in weld. Unlike the bolted connection or the riveted connection, where you get a ductile kind of a failure. So this is a very pertinent question. Has to be very, very careful when he is adopting this bridge. He has to inspect it very frequently. The moment he finds there is something is getting corrosion around, he must take care of it. And it's, if possible, it should be supported by a bolted kind of a connection.
I think Anurag ji has asked same question. Why IR can't be fixed strain sensor? Like being done worldwide for continuous strain signature monitoring of health assessments. The second question, what
Anurag ji has asked. I have already told, I believe in phase-wise assessment of the bridge. And this continuous bridge monitoring is required only for the research purposes, I would say. Otherwise, it should be the last resort.
I think the more or less all comments, 24 comments after that, two, three questions were there. Two were your sweet comment that one of the best lecture you have, they have heard. Sir, aapke liye maine kuch likha hai aur main pichle kareeban
question, I think 6-7 parts somebody has asked. Yeah. There are 6-7 parts in that question. I can answer.
Yeah, Dhavan sir.
Yeah. Isme maintenance guideline for maintenance of bowstring girder. This you have already asked this question. Why IR cannot fix strain sensors? This also, I think, I have replied. With large bridges more than 100 years old, IR sustainability assessment of bridge is needed, need of hour to avoid flood of. That's true. This is what I am saying.
Yes,
and then, but that's all, I think. Anybody else?
Yeah, I think the questions were there. Dhavan sir is there. I will forward your number, because every time after a lecture, I forward the number of the speaker to Dhavan sir. Okay. And he really he give all the questions, and really, you know, technocrat, we always find that he has, at this age, he has that enthusiasm to ask questions and keep the speakers and everyone in the student mode only. And thank you, Dr. Dhavan sir, for always your encouraging questions and all. We'll pass on the number to you. गोयल जी, इसी के साथ में मैं आपके लिए कुछ शब्द जो मेरी शायरी सिविल इंजीनियरिंग की शायरी नहीं कहूंगा, मैं आपके व्यक्तित्व पे शायरी करूंगा कि मैं पिछले 9 साल से आपको देख रहा हूँ एज अ मतलब चीफ इंजीनियर सीवी देन चीफ इंजीनियर। मैं देखता हूँ कि आप सिस्टम के बाहर या सिस्टम के अंदर या जो भी है, जो भी लोकहित में या जो भी बेनिफिट ऑफ द पीपल मास और उसके थ्रू हो, तो मैंने कुछ शब्द लिखे हैं कि मेरे को सबसे अच्छी बात आपकी लगती है कि यू नेवर गिव अप। तो उसके लिए लिखा था मैंने कि कितनी आसानी से कह दिया कि ये नहीं होगा हमसे, कितनी आसानी से कह दिया कि ये नहीं होगा हमसे। अगर ऐसा ही कहना था तो क्यों माँ बाप को सपने दिखाए। तो मतलब ये एक आपके लिए, यू फाइट अगेंस्ट इन फेवर एंड एवरीथिंग सो दैट यू कैन टेल अ सिस्टम। So overall to you, Goyal sir, very good. Actually, in fact, sitting at the in the government part, the detailing of engineering, this is one of the best thing. And really, in the executive committee also, your inputs are always well accepted and well done. Thank you very much, Goyal ji, for your usual talk on the subject. Although this topic which you have talked, we were afraid to take a course on that because it is very tough subject. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Vishal ji, with your permission, yeah. Dr. Vishal Thumre.
Yep,
with your permission, can I begin with the vote of thanks?
Before that, I just wanted to share with you that in Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai, please. We are having STAC committee, Standing Technical Advisory Committee. And right now, Mr. Bungiwal, he is one of the member in that STAC committee. And Dr. Borkar from Construma, he was also one of the member of STAC committee. We had come with a manual for bridges, and that manual is really, really very good. Okay. I mean, it talks about construction, it talks about quality control, even it talks about vision. So we can say that book is just a guideline or a small IRC code for MCGM. So of course, we have taken all the recommendations, all the guidelines from IRC and MORTH. And as per our Mumbai conditions, this STAC committee has come up with a book which contains all these technical things. Secondly, one of us were talking about some experts in departments. As we all know that most of engineers or most of the bridges are constructed or the clients are government. So for example, if we take example of MCGM, Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai, we have a transfer of after every three years. So in government department, there should be a policy that if whenever the engineer comes into certain department, he should be at least there for 10 years so that he will develop the skill and all the idea about design, quality control, instrument monitoring, health monitoring, etc., etc. So this has to be think in government. Of course, we are having a very, very good knowledgeable engineers all over the in government, but they should spend more years in particular department. Yeah, thank you, Ravindra Goyal sir. It was really very, very, very nice presentation. And before wasting any time, I will hand it over to Dr. Gopal Rai.
Before you conclude that, Bongi Roy Saab is here. Bongi Roy Saab is here. I greet him again and give you all greetings from my own director, VD Borkar. Dr. Saab referred to him, a wonderful engineer. He did his MSc in bridge engineering way back in Surrey, God knows how many years ago. But the point is, he's still a very active mind. I speak with him day now and again. I speak to him, and he is a very active mind. Old health, ill health at the moment. But the point is that book that Thumre Saab referred mostly in our office, and I have the copy. I'm very happy to share it with anyone if they need, if Thumre Saab gives permission. More than that, that is the document we gave Mr. C.P. Joshi, of president of IRC, to form the basis for that new overall code that they want to make. So yes, we were involved with that, and I'm happy to share that document with anyone. Thank you, sir. Thank you. That's what I wanted to just
add. Please share. Please share. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And with the very positive note, we begin the vote of thanks. First of all, let me thanks to Engineer R.K. Goyal ji, जिनमें अकेले चलने का हौसला होता है उनके पीछे एक दिन काफिला होता है. कि the subject which you are telling and the chair which you are sitting, I know it is very difficult and still you are managing all your expense, the bureaucracy part also. So over to you. Thank you very much for a lecture from your side and looking like it is very rare that sometimes a client speaks. So kabhi kabhi sunne milta hai, and when it's a valued engineer, it is always like appreciated by all the people. Thanks and keep growing, sir, and keep giving a lecture which you have. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let me thanks to today's panelist, Professor Pradipta Banerjee ji, for coming and giving his opinion on the talk and accepting IIB invitation to the panelists from his valuable time. Professor, thank you very much. Bahut bahut dhanyavaad. And let me thank you, Professor. Let me thanks to Dr. Vishal Thomre, the executive engineer from Coastal Road from the BMC, for as a moderator for today's lecture. Thank you, Vishal ji, for all your support
thank
and
you,
everything
thank you so much.
And encouraging us. Let me thanks to today the sponsors. Let me thanks to today's sponsors, the Machine Sense, to Mr. Majumdar and their colleagues. I think the list of their subordinates or the senior colleagues, Conrad Besmer, the chairman, and then Dr. Biplab Pal. Yeah, you want to give a thanks to him. And we will have definitely a lecture on 18th June, 6:30 p.m. On digital technology in structural health and public safety, a new for day. So this is a talk we'll have on it. We have talked and he has confirmed also. So thanks for accepting and thanks really for giving us sponsorship for a noble cause of IIB. And really it means a lot in such a way. You are supporting the institute. Thank you very much, Sudeep Majumdar ji. Let me thanks to our DG Dute sir for coming and giving his valuable comment. And to our president, Vinay Gupta ji, thank you always on the taking a good call and immediately respond. And he always very, we are lucky that we have the DG and president like that who supports us on left and right, every side from all the doubts we raise. Thank you very much, Vinay Gupta ji. Colleague, colleague Swapnil Joshi, the Honorary Secretary of IIB. Thanks to that, and thanks to all the executive committee who has came as a panelist and given his thanks to all executive committee. Atul sir left early because he wanted to attend some meeting, but he given high regards to R.K. Goyal sir for his talk. Let me thanks to Bongirwar sir for accepting and coming for the talk. And really, sir, keep coming, sir. Your presence encourage and it give energy, we can do some beautiful structure in India till. So thanks for encouraging SK Puri sahab also. Keep coming and keep encouraging the young team for the bridge engineers. So let me, the Deepika Singh, the engineer from IIB and Intento from project planning. And finally, the coordinator, Ruhi Agarwal. What I can do is, she is a connection between all the audience and the speakers and all. She take a good pain to coordinate such event. Let me thanks Ruhi. And I think Ruhi, this is your successfully 1 year with IIB. With Ruhi enter into the IIB, we started the lectures. And today is the 1 year. So congratulations, Ruhi. With your presence, we have done 23 lectures. And we have done one bridge engineering course. Okay. So thank you, Ruhi, for all your help and support.
Thank you so much.
Let me thanks to Huzaifa. Yeah, let me thanks to Huzaifa, all digital media, everything. We all civil engineer always understand the meaning of digital. Although Mr. Majumdar, 18, how the civil engineer can use digital things in the monitoring part. But till date, Huzaifa was our coordinator and he was the host and everything. Shafaji, and thanks to all the people who came, all attendees and all the members. And really, it was pleasure, Goel sir.
Thank
once
you.
Again, salute
thank you very much for listening.
And thank you very much, sir.
Actually, it was me to share my whatever I have learned. Thank you very much.
Really nice, elaborate, I must
thank
say.
You.
Micro as well as macro.
Very nice lecture.
That's it.
Thank
excellent.
You, sir.
Excellent, Ravindra. Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
We conclude. Jai Hind, sir.
Jai.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.